welcome back. Sorry, we have traveled a bit of distance there, so got the sunglasses on. It's still bright and hot out here in Africa. It's going to start cooling down, and when it starts cooling down, ideally you want to be either at a beautiful sunset spot with something cold in your hand. Except if you can be with a big cat. And if all goes well, we'll have that for you soon. But one of the most recognizable and beautiful animals in Africa, let's just have a quick look at those. Truly one of the most beautiful animals in the world, I think. If you look at the stripes and the patterns on them. Oh, look at this one's backside. Look at this one. Look at that mark. Speaking of big cats, that would have almost certainly been from a lion that tried to catch the zebra, would have jumped on the back of it, tried to hold on. The zebra would have kicked it. I've seen this a few times in the bush. The zebra kicks it so hard on the chest that the lion falls off, but it cuts the skin. And then when it heals, the stripes are slightly off center, if you want. They don't heal straight in line again. Just look at how interesting that looks. Now, that's a story to tell when he's talking to the other zebra. Beautiful little foal there as well. Two foals, three foals, in fact, in this group. I just love zebra, and I'm sure you do as well. Or shall I say zebra? Cody, well, you asked this question a little bit earlier. Cody, I know now from you from Indiana, you've asked a few questions. I always wonder where in Indiana. Do you know where Brazil, Indiana is? You were just asking, how often do we see zebra? Well, at the moment, we see it as we speak. But it's not all that often, to be fair, Cody. We don't get that many zebra and wildebeest. I mentioned this earlier with the blue wildebeest as well in this area. We don't have a lot of big open areas. This is obviously a nice open area. And in fact, we are sitting very, very close to Arathusa Lodge, Djuma Game Reserve, and Arathusa Game Reserves. That's the two areas that we drive in Sabi Sands, and that we get this amazing wildlife spectacle experience on. Speaking of which, as the black and white striped backsides walk away from us with the tail swishing, Isabella, if you're still watching, you were asking about tails earlier. Zebras, they've got the busiest tails of all animals, always swishing. Even sometimes, like that one that had the lion that must have caught it or tried to catch it, sometimes their tails are bitten off. And even then, when the tail is this long, it's still swishing all the time. So their tails work hard. But guys, I don't want to get you too excited. You're probably not going to stay with me for now. You're going to go somewhere else. But if all goes well, I might not be able to give you a cold drink in hand for sundowner yet. But I'm hoping that we might have a big cat for you soon. Let's go see.
The best, but otherwise you won't. Now, just before we go to our advert break, we're going to sneak a little bit further forward and see if we can't spot that impala lamb. I think that impala lamb was probably born today. And I'm sure, I don't know if Peter or Jamie have explained this to you, but we're into the lambing season. They'll lamb there down probably within 2 weeks of each other, all the impala. And so the whole place is going to be swimming in little impala lambs very soon, which is just wonderful. It's not so wonderful for them. Less than 50% of those little things will make it to their first birthday. I think they've gone into the bush there. So let's just enjoy these wildebeest. You can see they've relaxed. Then they're relaxed because we're not behaving like predators. So we're not crouching behind bushes and trying to hide behind trees. We're just approaching them totally in the open. And so they'll let us get a lot closer than they would otherwise. We'll just keep going here. And see how close we can get. We're going to go off to an advert break in about 20 seconds. And we'll see after the advert break if we can be right upon them. We'll see you just after this. So everyone on the internet, we will keep trying to do this. I think we might actually stand by here. We're really doing rather well at getting close to them. Keep sending through your questions. We do still love to hear from you on the internet, even though you might not be watching on television. You might be watching from Finland or from Australia or Russia or Djibouti, if you know where Djibouti is. Jean-André, do you know where Djibouti is? Well done. Djibouti, interestingly, it's got nothing to do with wildebeest, everyone, but Djibouti is one of the four countries in the world that begins with D. Chandra, do you know the other four?
Denmark.
Yeah, that's it, Denmark.
Russia,
no, no. Democratic Republic of the Congo. And one more in the Caribbean. There we go. Andre's no mug, I tell you. He can shoot a camera and he can find his way around the world. Now, I'm getting it in the ear from Final Control about when we're going to see a wildebeest birth. That wildebeest cow there, I think, is enormously pregnant. Except, I don't think it's a cow, Andre. I've just spotted something hanging between its legs. So quite possibly not that one. I don't think that one's going to give birth, ever. Sorry about that, everyone. It must have been something about the way the light was catching it. Oh dear, the Russian in the Final Control has made me look like a fool. There are actually five countries. There's Dominica and the Dominican Republic. Thank you, Alex. No vodka for you tonight. So I'm going to just sneak towards this tree, this fallen marula tree. And, well, there are lots of things to discover in it. But let's just see, it'll give us a little bit of cover, but not too much so that we're actually hidden. The wildebeest can still see us walking. We've still got 3 minutes to go to the advertisement's end. All right, so everybody, there's good news for Big Cat Week. So let's go across to Peter.
Hey guys, well, firstly, welcome back this side. We're still in ad break, as you know, and I want to make this really exciting for the other people when they do join us, because it's always exciting to see a leopard in the beginning. So we're going to look at Tingana, but when they come back and they join us again, we're going to start here again, and we're going to explain to them where we are. So enjoy the leopard sort of real private view for now. When everyone joins us back on TV, we're going to start this sort of from the beginning, just to make it a bit more exciting for them. It's always lovely, that first moment when you see a leopard, but look at this. Any leopard is magic. And many of you, let's get some IDs. I'm not going to tell you who this is. Let us know who this is. You know how it works. I don't have to explain it. Let's see the first two or three people to ID this for us. I'll give you a hint. It's a leopard. Since we have a bit of time, we're going to just sit to the other side. It's nice to know before everyone else what we're looking at. I'm loving these ad breaks, by the way. For me, it's this really sort of personal time with many of you who are close friends already. And we're going to just have to move around to get a better view. 15 seconds or so before everyone else gets back. Good job, Marisha from Texas. Good ID, Tingana. Well guys, perfect timing. You got back just in time from the ad break. We arrived here a few minutes back. We're just finding a better view at the moment. And as we said, one of the best things you can do on safari as the sun gets low in the horizon is to see this. Welcome to Nat.Geo Wild Big Cat Week. This is not only a big cat, but he's about as big as they get. This is a beautiful male. We've had a few people help us with the ID already. He's a male known as Tingana. Isn't that a beautiful name? Tingana. It means shy or elusive, which is a trait that he had when he arrived here, but now he's become very habituated and we get to really see him in a beautiful way. And the first person to help us with that ID earlier was Marisha from Texas. We said thanks already. It's so nice to have people on drive that have been on many drives with us, and they get into the animals and the characters and all the stories of what happens out in safari. And as you can imagine, some of the main characters out here are these cats. They're absolutely mesmerizing. Big male, he's probably weighing about 80 kilograms, give or take. That's about 175, 180 pounds even, size of a big man. And he's just gorgeous. Hello, Mandy. And an even bigger hello to Hunter. Hello, Hunter. Awesome when young people are on safari with us, Hunter. And I've said this earlier, Isabella was also asking a question. She's also 4, the same as you. My daughter, Sydney, is the same age as you as well. So fantastic to have you on drive with us. And Hunter, you were just wondering how big is this leopard. Now, I did just say he's about 170 to 180 pounds. I'm trying to think, Hunter, you would be weighing, I'm guessing you weigh about 15 kilograms, 20. So let's say you weigh about 40 pounds. So he would weigh 4 to 5 times as much as you. Big animal. And not only is he big, but he's incredibly strong. The muscle, the coordination, and the sort of athleticism, if you want, of leopard are almost unparalleled. Their ability to move fast, to balance, to be dead quiet when they're stalking is fascinating. Leopard are just absolutely amazing to watch. I've never seen a leopard, and this goes again for this moment when I saw him. I've never seen a leopard without my heart jumping, skipping a beat when I see it. My mood instantly gets even better, and I'm pretty much in a good mood most of the time when I'm in the bush. And I'm always just so happy to see a leopard. They're so special to see. Guys, Anthony from Philadelphia, I'm going to answer your question shortly. You were just asking how many leopards are in this area, but just quickly to explain to you, you can see he's got his eyes closed and his tongue sticking out. Now, he's got his tongue out because he's hot, which is also why he's breathing quite fast. But he's got his eyes closed. Well, put it this way, I would be doing the same thing at the moment, but I have to watch what's going on so I can tell you about it. But there's lots of these little flies around. Earlier when Hayden was showing that giraffe skull, you could see the Mupani flies, those little black flies. And there's lots of them around. They're climbing into my ear and into my eyes every now and again. So at least I know that even if you're a regal, beautiful leopard, the same insects can bug you as it bugs me as well. But you were just asking how many leopards in this area. Now let's just explain to you the area again. In fact, we'll show you just now. But we are in South Africa, so at the bottom end of the African continent, in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, which is part of the Greater Kruger National Park. Millions of acres of wild bushveld. And in Sabi Sands, the two areas that we move around in or on is Djuma Game Reserve, where we were earlier with the elephant, and Arathusa Game Reserve, where we are sitting right now. We're sitting not very far from Arathusa Lodge, where we saw the zebra earlier. And in that area that we can traverse, that we can move around in, we have two big male leopard that we see often, Mvula, we saw him a couple of days ago, and Tingana. They're the two dominant males. Then we have some females that we see most often, Karula, Shadow, one of her daughters, Tandi, one of her other daughters. Those are the leopard we see most often, but there's many of them that come through this area. Kunyuma is another male, Quarantine is another male, not so long ago, We had some other young leopards around this area as well. Sindile, the daughter of Shadow. Anderson is another big male, very big, even bigger than Tingana. He's further south. We see him sometimes. Brent had him the other day. So it just depends on who's moving through the area. But leopard are territorial. They stay in certain areas, so you get to know them. Guys, well, we've just had a nice comment there, and I'm sure this is a thought running through many of our minds. Isn't it absolutely amazing how this leopard is just not minding us at all? We're sitting here, there's another game drive also with happy people on the back. And that's just because this leopard has gotten used to us. In fact, this leopard, his name, Tingana, means shy or elusive. When he arrived in this area, he wasn't used to vehicles that much, but he set up a territory, he had a good area, females in the area, and he very quickly got used to vehicles being around him. And that's a very important thing to notice, guys. You must realize, and I know I've said this many times, but I'm going to say it again. If you've heard me before, please excuse me. If this is the first time, you'll understand better. One of the things that's truly amazing about this area, apart from that it's beautiful and breathtaking and incredible and awesome and all those beautiful words, but is that the animals like this leopard, they get, I'm sure you can see the flies behind. In fact, you'll see some sitting here as well. Animals like this leopard get so used to our presence, and because our presence is always positive, in other words, we don't bother them, we don't chase them, we don't harass them, we don't make noises and funny movements, we always behave in a sort of a polite, respectful way, they learn that we don't bother them. And that's amazing, because we get to not only see them up close is obviously nice, but we get to experience them. Being close to a leopard is one thing, but to see what it's doing, in this case, he's sleeping, fair enough, that's what he's doing, but to see them mating or hunting or moving, or in this case later on, when he gets up, he'll probably be scent marking. Cheers, guys. Another game drive leaving. Always nice to see people in there, but these big smiles on their faces after leaving a leopard sighting. But the behavior we get to see is really special. We get to have intimate views into the lives of leopard and lion and elephant, all the big animals, but especially the cats. Leopard, lion, cheetah sometimes, but leopard and lion in this area is very, very good. And you get to experience them, what they would do normally. If he's scent marking later on, he'll be marking his area. He's a dominant male. We might get him calling like we had that lion the other day. And the behavior we see is really special. So at the moment, he's just got his eyes open again at least. It seems the flies are bugging him less. This really is something that I always like to mention, is that we see intimate, up-close behavior. Sharon, you asking when do they hunt? Well, again, I don't want to, you know, sort of throw wishes out there, but they hunt sort of any time from now onwards. Sharon, they hunt, well, firstly, any time of the day. And again, I say this every time. I'll say it every time in the future when I'm asked this. Predators are successful because they're opportunistic. So they will hunt whenever there's chance. But typically, statistically, that would fall more often in late afternoon, early evening, early morning, after and before sunrise as well. So before and after dawn, before and after dusk, or that time period. That's when the light is best for them, when the sound and everything works and they can camouflage well, and in all aspects, that's the typical time for hunting. This guy could get active any minute. We could sit here another 10 minutes. Look at how beautiful that is. The low light dipping behind the clouds there. Beautiful bushveld, dead log, and a magnificent male leopard. So we might be lucky enough to actually go hunt with him soon. Well, Cheryl, I can certainly echo your words. Cheryl is just saying that this is breathtakingly beautiful to her. Cheryl, I can't put it any better than that. I fully agree. In fact, with leopard, I sometimes literally have that where you lose a breath because you just go, you know, it's unbelievable. I have to sit here sometimes pinching myself still today after having done this for years. No other animal takes my breath away like a leopard does. And he's going to get up soon if we're lucky. It looks like he wants to move. And when he does get up, you will see a leopard is just poetry in motion. It's cliched, but it's true. They are so beautiful to watch. They are like liquid mercury moving through the bush, like the wind, like mist in the mornings, like the clouds before the sun. It is just beautiful to watch them. And I think we're going to see it this afternoon. Andy, you were asking again, how big is a leopard's territory? Sorry, not how big is a leopard. I was going to just mention that again, because as he moved, you could get a sense for his size. the territories, I don't know exactly this cat's territory, but he's probably got about 3,000 hectares, 3,500 hectares. That would be, in acres, about 9,000 acres, give or take. Maybe a bit more than that even. Tingana, I'm just thinking, he's recently pushed into Mvula's area towards the east. So maybe a bit more, maybe 12, 13,000 acres. That can vary as well between different males and also different habitats. And if there's a lot of density of females, like closer to the big river systems, the area will be smaller because you'll have enough females in that area. Okay. Look, Carla, I missed a little bit of your question there. We're just going to move slightly. I want to try and get you that sort of, we always say down the barrel, you know, when you look straight down into his eyes. And we're the only vehicle now, so we can move a little bit. And obviously Tingana, being such a super leopard, won't be bothering him. But I want to give you a look straight into his eyes, because it is chilling in such a beautiful way. Sorry, Carla, just repeat your question for me, please. Oh, look at this. Yes, Carla, good question. You were asking if they ever stay together, male or female, or whether they're solitary. Carla, they're pretty much like this most of the time, on their own. You will see them together when they're mating. Sometimes some of them will share kills with each other, and sometimes you will see them fighting, maybe males competing with each other. But typically, you will see them solitary. Only under certain conditions will you see them together. But what a treat to be sitting so close to one of Africa's most elusive, but certainly most beautiful and mesmerizing animals, the leopard. If I've ever seen a leopard make a kill, now, since he's not doing too much at the moment, other than probably chasing away flies like we are with his ears, yes, we have. I've seen it a few times. It's not something you see often. You have to be very lucky, and certainly one of the most vivid memories for me in terms of wildlife experiences was in October. We came out here. Oh, he's going to give us a yawn. Oh, yeah. Hey, that's the business end of a leopard. Now you know what it looks like. If you're seeing that up close, you're in trouble. Liam was also in the vehicle that day with me, and we had one of the most hair-raising, goosebumpy experiences I've had in my life, where we had a leopard kill. In the hour that we had for the show, there was a window 3 minutes into the live broadcast where we heard the alarm calls and we found the leopard shadow, which he just killed. In fact, he was still busy killing an impala, and it was unbelievable. The hyenas came and stole it away from us, and absolutely mind-blowing. So not only have I seen a leopard in a hunt make a kill, but it was in a place where we had people joining us from around the world to experience it. So that was absolutely stunning, and a true privilege to have been part of that experience and to share it. This leopard doesn't look like he's doing too much for now, except for shaking his head and yawning a bit now and again. We're going to show you something a little bit smaller, but no less spectacular on the walk with James. We will see you back here in a bit.
Well, from 6 tons all the way down to a couple of grams, just a grasshopper sitting perfectly camouflaged on a stick. The only reason I saw him was that he actually flew up and landed there. Now, as with the elephant, we must check the wind direction just in case he should take offense to us. I am, of course, joking. The grasshopper is unlikely to react to a smell. Now, there are lots and lots of grasshoppers around at the moment, and they're eating away at, unsurprisingly, the fresh grass shoots that have come out as a result of the rain. Let's go back to the leopard, and we'll keep walking and discovering on the way here.
Well, guys, sorry to interrupt your on-foot experience there, but this is the thing with wild animals. They do what they want when they want. And Tingana is on the move. is listening. You see there? Now keep in mind, we said earlier, he'll most likely be scent marking or patrolling his territory, moving around, asserting his position here again as dominant male. But whenever, however, if an opportunity to hunt presents itself, he will hunt. So that could happen at any second. Coming back to that question earlier, if I've ever seen a hunt, recently I did, shared it live. I'll be honest with you, it's an amazing experience, and if it happens again now, you will be as excited as I will be. There he goes, scent marking. There you can go, urine spray mark. Little squirt of urine, he rubs the face in the leaves. He's got these sort of facial glands, if you want, around the whiskers. And he leaves that scent, and we're gonna have a great time with him now. Okay, let's move a little bit. We've got about 3 minutes or so to go before we're taking a short break. So we're going to stay with him, try and show what we can. All these little bits of sort of sandy patches like that you can see, that is from warthogs. Now we wouldn't want to fall into one of those holes because we will be stuck. But he was looking at those as well, but they don't seem to be too active. There he is listening again. And now you were just asking if leopards have families like prides. No, they don't. They're solitary, the females, when they raise the young. Typically they have two young, or one, but normally two, and if they're lucky they raise both. If they're not lucky, they don't raise any of them. Guys, great questions, by the way. I just have to tell you that it's so awesome to get such nice questions from you. And the Paige, beautiful name, by the way, I've always loved the name Paige. You're asking, why do leopards have white tips on their tails? Let's quickly show you what Paige is talking about as he's walking away. It's the perfect opportunity. Look at that. The tail tip of a leopard often indicates its mood. If it's curious or excited or aggressive, you'll see it in the twitch of the tail. And then very important, for the females especially, the tail tips will be a very clear visual marker for the young leopard to follow mum when they're walking. But not only follow, but also see her mood. If she's walking and suddenly the tail is flicking, they will scratch down because maybe she's hunting. Watch the twigs there. I'm going to try and go a little bit around. He might climb up onto this termite mound if we're lucky. Ah, oh, look at that. What an amazing cat. There he goes. Oh, lovely bit of sunset glow in the background there. Wow. Look at that dewlap. You see under his throat? Is it, you get it? And they make this beautiful throaty call. We call it sawing. They go like this. I don't want to make it too loud now because he's close. Not that he'll really care about me, but beautiful sound they make, and that neck and that flap plays a role in making that call. Oh. Try and get little bit next to him here. Another vehicle also with us. Beautiful light now. Oh, I just love this time of day. Sharon, you were just asking how often do they hunt? Well, every few days, but he's quite lean. Looking at him, hunting would be high on his list of priorities. But I'm so excited. High on his list of priorities. And certainly the possibility for him to hunt in the next 10, 20, 30 minutes is very possible. So after the break, make sure you're back here. Who knows what's going to happen? It's wild. See you now. This is so awesome. I'm having a blast. This is Ephraim, is a good friend of mine. To let us go in front the whole time now. And guys, believe me, the possibility of a hunt today is very, very possible. And other good news as well, just to keep you sort of in the inside loop, because you're very much part of the inside loop right now, is he's also moving further into Arathusa, which is good news for us. One, two is also moving into better and better signal range for us. So everything is shaping up for a perfect sunset safari experience with Tingana the leopard. And he's just stopped at a thermite mine there. Oh, look at that view. Oh, he's moving again. That was beautiful. He was just sort of scoping out his next area, scouting ahead. Let's try and get up ahead of him. Oh, stunning. Oh, I'm just right here. This is too much. He's disappearing behind the... I mean, literally, there he is. Unbelievable. I'm going to say this a million times in my life still, hopefully, but this still blows my mind. Unbelievable. Look at that coat. Look at the light on him. Late afternoon light just sort of dappling through the leaves here. Look at that tail tip. Fun in the world to do this the way we are doing it right now. All these components to consider, amazing cat to spend time with. You guys, obviously, the best guest in the world. I think I'm going to answer that next time I ask me in an interview. Who do you take on safari? I'll just say the best guest in the world. My family, my friends, other wildlife passionate people, keen photographers, keen. Just people that love this. Oh, look at this. Look at the light on him. Look at the light on that. That is unbelievable. Oh, isn't that stunning? You see, every now and again, he stops, he looks, he listens, and then he continues on. I'm going to try and stay. Happy days. I just want to see, we've almost got everyone joining us again, and we're going to try and give them the same view that we enjoyed. Let's have fun. Well guys, welcome back. Firstly, the leopard is just over there, and we've just been chatting on the vehicle. We had a beautiful view, in fact twice. We had a stunning view from up front as he's moving along. He is hunting, and we decided to try and find another view like that for when you rejoin us. I'd love to show you that same view. And he's just zigzagging a bit, so I have to try and outguess him as to where he's going. Because, as I said, he is definitely on the hunt. Oh, we're gonna get it. Look at that. We should walk right along this pathway here towards us. And this is what I was hoping you would share with us. Look at that. I'm not gonna say anything for a few seconds. Just listen and look. Hear the wind and the birds. How he's looking, how he's checking, smelling, walking right behind us. He's maybe a foot behind us at the moment. VM could almost grab him if he was considering something like that. As the things you're seeing, that's the radio antenna that we used to talk to the other game drives. He is feet away from us, and he is on the hunt. Look at that tail tip curled up like that. Oh, Michael, good question. How far do leopards travel in one day? They can travel many kilometers for big males when they're patrolling the area, and sometimes not far at all if they've got some food or maybe cubs to look after. It just depends on the conditions. But on average, probably a mile or so a day, mostly at night. He's moving some thick stuff. We're obviously going to stick with him. But for now, we also have some beautiful, fantastic, and perhaps the cutest little animal you're going to see in a long time with Jamie. Enjoy it. We'll see you back in a bit.
It's hard to believe that this bundle of wobbly legs could one day grow up to be Tingana the leopard's arch nemesis. At the moment, though, this little hyena cub is going the furthest it's ever gone before. Whoopsie daisy, slight speed wobble there. Back legs are still not. Aw, that doesn't help. The older cub really not playing the part of the gentle older sibling or gentle older cousin. I think making life a little bit tricky for the explorations of this young cub. Oh dear, falling over completely. And this is definitely the bravest that we've ever seen this young hyena cub. It's only a couple of weeks old and finally starting to come out and explore at the moment, discovering the joys of elephant dung. If, of course, it can escape the attentions of the older cub. Oh, itchy ear. Now, those itches and scratches are caused by parasite buildup around the den site. It could be that at some point soon, Mom is going to have to move her cub out of this den to a nice, cleaner start. Oh, head around, mouth around neck there, running back towards the safety of Mom. Oh, no, distraction. Different direction. So much learning happening here. This is why they're my favorite predator on this reserve. Such clever little creatures. There's Mom lying off to the side, keeping a close eye on what's happening with her young cub before flopping back down and, just like every other animal out here, panting exhaustedly in the afternoon heat. She really is a beautiful young hyena. Come on, little one, are you coming back to Mom? Yes. Oh, I wouldn't chew on that. That's got thorns. That's definitely got thorns. It's one of the first signs of a hyena den active, where they chew around the branches. But I believe that Peter has repositioned, but never fear, we will stick with this cute little cub for now. But let's head across and have a look at that gorgeous spotted cat.
Well, guys, firstly, welcome back. We're still with this leopard, but he's gone into some very tricky terrain now. Not terrain as much as habitat. Thick, lots of shrub. Good hunting area, though. By the way, isn't that hyena cub just amazing? I mean, we spent a lot of time with her, and we'll do so in future again. Absolutely beautiful. Here he is, Tingana. And make no mistake, he's on the hunt. He's moving, winding, and weaving his way through the underbrush, zigzagging, testing the wind, looking, listening. Everything a hunting leopard is to do. The chance that we might have a hunt with him is certainly not, I would say, at least 70% this afternoon. Guys, this is very tricky terrain. As I said, please don't worry about how we're driving. This kind of habitat, from a soil point of view, comes very well with vehicles going off-road. From a bush point of view, these things we're driving over, elephants flatten them all the time, they eat them all the time. In our case, they're very sort of springy type of bush. So if you drive through it, like this one, you would bend it over, and when you go through, it pops back up again afterwards. This habitat is designed to cope with big animals, whether it's elephant, rhino, buffalo, Land Rovers, who knows. It's seen it all before. So don't worry about it. It is something we're careful with. For instance, I make sure I don't drive over it with my tires, because firstly, I don't want to squash it. It goes between the tires. These cars are very high off the ground. They just pop up. And also, I don't want a flat tire because I have a leopard to follow. So, hey, watch out there. Oh, he's under the little track. It's funny enough, this track doesn't actually exist on the maps anymore. We're in the middle of a big block and we found this old car track here. It would be brilliant if he follows it because it makes this whole adventure easier. Great job there on the back. He's not only doing all the camera work, he's also looking after the gear on the back. Guys, watch this leopard. As I said earlier, it is art the way they move. That is how beautiful it is. But also watch him. He'll stop every now and again. He will listen. He will look. He will test the breeze. He's moving right into the wind now. Very good thing to do for hunting. Very typical thing as well. The wind not only brings him scent of what's ahead of him, it hides his scent from what's ahead of him again. So moving into the wind is good for that. Also helps to hide his sound. Even his movement, the twigs and the leaves and the things moving in the wind helps to make his shape even more difficult to see. There he stopped again. Lovely habitat. You're just looking through all the branches of the trees. These are mostly red bush willows, one of the combretums. Very good grazing for things like, or browsing, sorry, for the leaves, for things like kudu. What's he smelling? He's got the scent of something. Kudu, impala, giraffe, which will be too big for him, but he would be able to take impala, young kudu, even female kudu. You could also find duiker, a little antelope you get here, steenbok, another small antelope, warthogs perhaps, all these different things. Obviously they would try and see him as well. Just try and stick with him. Not the easiest of terrains. Oh guys, enjoy the walk quickly. Something interesting there. We're going to find another view and get you back here shortly.
So just a quick one, everybody. That 6-ton elephant bull would have been responsible for any number of deaths to trees like this. A huge knobthorn tree, and I'm standing underneath the rootstock. The immense power and strength it took to push over this giant of the wilderness is quite astonishing. I'm standing in the hole where it was. The rootstock is over 6 feet tall, and the elephant managed to push this over. It really is quite astonishing. Anyway, that was this little thing. Let's head across to another hole in the ground where there's a tiny little cub playing about. We'll continue into the sunset.
Our favorite little new arrival is still dashing about and exploring its new world, and teething at the same time. And it's already just watching this little one. Every now and again, it opens its mouth. Oh, overbalance there. And you can see the sharp teeth coming through. Now, those of you at home with puppies or kittens, you'll know just how sharp those baby teeth are. And I'm sure it's putting them to good use, chewing on sticks and sometimes other hyenas, going up there to say hello to its playmate. Oh, and the elephant dung. Back to the elephant dung. So many new smells. Now, I've said that these carnivores are my favorite, and that's because they are the most incredibly intelligent out there. Their social communication, out of all of the predators, is probably completely unrivaled. We've got a really nice example to answer Pablo's question as our little black pup digs through the hyena dung. The older one uses it as a headrest. Now, Pablo wants to know at which age the cubs start getting their spots. And we've got a nice comparison here between the cub that is 6 months old, the older one. And, as Tingana is doing something interesting, so we're going to head across to him. I'll be back with you shortly.
Well, welcome back here again. Amazing to think of all the interesting things happening in the bush right now. Just with us, the two vehicles, the walk. That's just three places. Imagine all the millions of things happening at this moment. As fascinating as this. He stopped again, had a look. I was hoping that he might use this termite mound as a vantage point. They sometimes do that, but he seems to have something in mind. A few seconds ago, about half a minute ago, it looked to me like he saw something. I couldn't see what it is, but might be that he's smelling something. That hunter's instinct is in full working mode at the moment. This is it. Some twigs. You're just talking about that. It's called a dewlap. Under the leopard's neck like this, you've got this big, heavy skin. You get it with the females as well when they get older. But you see, it's specifically the big males. And as far as I know, that helps a little bit with them in their calling. Some fat layers in there that helps to sort of resonate the sound. I don't understand it very well, but it's part of that. But it is certainly something you see the leopards when they get older. Look at his nose low to the ground, definitely smelling something. The way he's looking is almost as if he's trailing something, like he's tracking it at the moment. You can see just looking at the bush around us now, what time is it? 20 past six already. Time flies when you're having fun. Or more specifically, when you're busy tracking a leopard through the bush on a hunt. This is hunting time. What I wanted to say is to watch leopard in. It's almost as if you could just sense that they move through this part of the day, I don't know, like thought through the mind of a poet, or like, you know, the use of colors in the hand of a painter or something. It's just something just so magical about leopard this part of the day. The sounds are pretty beautiful. You can hear the birds calling, you can hear the wind rustling the leaves above us. Oh, look at those eyes. Oh, he's walking straight to us. Look how close he is. Again, right past us. He was about this far from the car. You couldn't see him. He was too close. Where's he going? Oh, he's just walking along. Let's just turn a bit. Guys, welcome to Big Cat Week. That was a perfect example of why you're here. And you know what's amazing is this is live. If you don't realize that, this is 100% live. If that cat does something now, if he suddenly chases something for a hunt, or if hyenas come up and chase him up into a tree, you're going to be right here to see it. So glad you could join us. Hayley, good question. Do leopards rely mostly on sight, sound, or smell when hunting? So make sure our gear is back. All right. As if you... Oh. Sorry, Hayley, let's see what he gets up to. Guys, remind if you lose us for a second here or there, a little flash or something, that's because of all the technology that enables you to join us here in Africa. We are driving through some bush and sometimes the antenna at the back bends over. And Hayley, a leopard, like all hunters, well, like all predators and prey, use all these sights all of the time. You know, in some ways, you know, maybe if you hear the wind blowing, you can maybe smell better because you know that the smell is coming from that side. So I even think that different senses can help to sort of enhance each other. But he's certainly very much aware of his surroundings in every aspect of his sensory abilities. Sight, sound, smell, touch would also play a very big role because those paws of his have got fine hairs all along the toes, and he can feel as he's putting his feet down before a twig breaks or anything like that. What did he see? What did he see? What did he see? Look at that. Look at the posture change. Guys, I've said this many times, but when you're in the hunt, well, at least me, and I know many of you feel the same, when the hunt happens, that primal instinct in me that is a hunter after all wakes up in a way that surprises me every time. So brace yourself if this goes into action, because it might happen at any stage. Zigzagging a bit. This termite mound, which is that sort of, I don't know, termite mound, you know what I'm talking about, anthill if you want. This is where we were sitting earlier with him, or waiting for him, so he's just moving around. Maybe he's smelling something or hearing something. Moving around quickly. scent marking. Look at that. Look at that. Scent marking, tail up. Oh, he's going to walk right towards us. Look at this. He's going to walk over this log here. Listen. Guys, very good question there from Jeff, just as he's walking past us. Jeff, you're just asking, why would we be following him when he's hunting? Very good question, Jeff. It's always important to consider, obviously, any other species that you interact with. The reason for this is, well, firstly, it's amazing to see and experience. Secondly, it doesn't actually affect him too much. In fact, I have to make sure that I don't help him if he wants in the hunt. And there are ways that you could do that. We obviously won't do that. With a spotlight later on, you try not to put the light in the eyes of the prey, for instance. This doesn't affect him. We're making a bit of noise. Animals are all used to vehicles being around this area. They see Land Rovers like ours all the time, and they know that these vehicles are driving through the bush. So, strangely enough, it doesn't affect the prey species either. He's circling the same area. I wonder if he's smelling something here. Maybe there's a warthog that comes to sleep here at night in one of these burrows, or something that he's waiting for. It certainly feels like there's a bit of a plan for him here. Jeff, just to finish that question. Hunting. So we are just here to see this, to celebrate this. Wildlife moment. Experience, we know that it won't affect him in any way, really, nor will it affect his prey species. Although I must say, with a certain plan in mind to weave around these bushes. We should get him just now. We're going to take a short break just now, but we're going to stay with him. Anything can happen, as you know. See you back here just now for more Big Cat Week. Just for those of you that might be new to the safari experience, these bushes and things we're driving over, they just pop back up again afterwards. I don't drive over them with my wheels, I drive over them sort of between the wheels. This vehicle is very well raised off the ground. It's got special off-road suspension in it. By the way, this is probably the best vehicle in the world for doing what we're doing right now. So thank you very much, everyone from Wild Earth, Graham, and everyone from Nat.Geo, for giving me such a cool toy to play with. Such a fantastic thing to do. Such an amazing thing to share. Doesn't really get better than this for me, to be honest. Who wouldn't want to do this? I mean, any boy growing up in Africa, I was lucky enough to grow up with great exposure to wildlife in wilderness areas. And you can only ever dream of being this. In fact, I couldn't even dream of being this. It's better because it's live. Here he goes. Oh, guys, yes. We're going to follow this guy. Hopefully it gets a bit more open. But that hyena den activity is just too cute. Enjoy it. We'll see you back in a bit.
When you run out of sticks to chew on, the next best thing is your den mate, who provides for quality entertainment for this little cub. We think that the youngest one is a female. She's very bold and very brave and seems to be behaving in a way that would suggest it. Oh, piggyback time. Climbing bodily onto the older cub, who is being very tolerant. Although every now and again a little warning nip is administered, it's never anything too serious. Probably because the older cub knows that mom is keeping a watchful eye and ear open at the base of the den site. She's also exhausted and trying to catch a cat nap every now and again, or a hyena nap. hours, jaws would be capable of crushing bone. Whoop. Yes. Now what do we do? Interesting to see. She might be the matriarch's daughter, but just by the way they interact, there's very little submission shown from her to the matriarch. It makes me wonder if they're not part of the same family line. Whatever it is, she's definitely doing a fantastic job of raising a very healthy cub. He's still hidden away. Looks in need of a meal, though. Does seem quite hungry. Older cub coming down now. That bounding lope that hyenas are so good at. I'm quite possibly feeling very hungry. Oh, for the older cub, it's right at the point of starting to share between eating meat and drinking milk from mom. She will continue to lactate for another year or so. So hyenas will feed their cubs right up to a year and a half. But once they reach the 6-month period, then the mothers come back to the den less and less. Sometimes every second day or every third day. Now, as the hyena cub rests on the elephant dung, let's head back across to Peter and see what Tingana is up to.
Guys. On the hunt, he's just spotted a warthog. He went flash of it. I think the warthog slipped away, but for a minute yeah, he's going again. I think the warthog's gone. But he did go for it for a second. I thought we were going to see it. Well, you might not see him that easily, but one of the most and I think this is what he's been hunting at. There's lots of burrows here. In fact, I've got to be very careful with the driving to get out, but not while you're fighting a leopard on the hunt. You want to be mobile with it. I just saw a flash of it. But the way he's behaving might suggest that maybe it was a female warthog with young ones. Young warthog now would be about a year old. We haven't seen new arrivals yet, so would be about a year old warthog if there's any left in there. And this is one of the ways leopard hunt. They wait at the exit hole. And when that warthog comes out, they grab it. Look at how carefully he's moving. Definitely, look at that. He's reversing. Look at his tail, how he's keeping it steady. Look at how he's balancing with his tail. Look at that tail shape. Look at that. No twig. He doesn't want to break anything. Oh, guys, this is amazing. Look, 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 look. I don't want to move now because he's just waiting there. He's just waiting for another warthog to come out, I think. Sue, good question. I'm just going to move a little bit. So we can see the entrance to that hole. If something happens here, we're going to be in the perfect spot for this. Unbelievable. Okay. We're going to have to wait here just as quietly as him now. Sue, out of New Jersey, welcome on Safari Live. And flash in the bush. We were a little bit far behind catching up to him. That warthog ran away. I think he's either certain of, or at least considers the possibility that there are other warthogs in that hole. And that's what he's waiting for. And soon no alarm calls. I can hear some birds in the distance. Fork-tailed drongo calling. Franklin's typical sounds on the onset of night. And maybe one of the sounds that we never hear but always hear in the bush, and that is the quiet of the hunter. The movement of the stork. The patient waiting to pounce. All of those sounds we can hear at the moment. It's so quiet that you can hear the wind in the leaves, mostly of this red bush willow around us. I can hear each fly flying around my head. It's a very good place to keep watching. That tail tip will often be the first indication of interest or excitement. And Cody, asking again, what hunting style do they use? Well, any hunting style, really, depending on the circumstance, but leopards especially, stalking and pouncing, so getting very close to their prey, using that camouflage, using that great balance they have to move quietly, and getting as close to the prey as possible and then just pouncing the last few feet. As opposed to wild dog, for instance, they'll run down their prey, or lion that will often try and sort of form a, what you call a bull's horns hunting technique, or a Shaka Zulu used it a lot in his warrior sort of strategy, is you try and circle your prey, you form the, like the horns of a bull or the horns of a buffalo around your prey. That's more for lions. Leopard, stealth, quietly moving through the bush, getting close to the prey, and then pouncing on it. Although this, what we're watching now, I've seen this a few times in the past, where they actually wait for the warthogs at the entrance of their burrows. And this works early evening like this, or early morning, just around sunrise. When the warthogs are coming out, they wait there for them sometimes. Not an easy prey, make no mistake. A warthog, a big warthog, can weigh the same as this leopard, but let's say an average size warthog would be 40, 50 kilograms. That's about 110 pounds or so. It's a little bit less than the leopard, but still very powerful, very strong. And warthogs, of course, have got those tusks. And on the lower jaw, they have very sharp tusks. So they've got the bigger tusk on the top jaw. And on the bottom jaw, they have the sharper, small, the sort of slightly smaller tusks. And those lower tusks, they've got the big tusks here, and the smaller tusk, and those lower tusks rub up against the top tusk, and they're sharp like the edge of a knife. And they can easily kill a leopard even. Guys, but I think let's watch him again. I mean, very possibly nothing's going to happen. Keep in mind, probably 80%, 90% of hunts end up in nothing happening other than the prey running away and the predator deciding to try again. Sometimes the prey gets away. Other times it might not come out the hole. But other times, the hunter is successful. Who knows what it'll be this time? That's the beauty of life. Anything can happen at any split second, and we wouldn't know until it does. You wouldn't, I wouldn't. We're gonna keep watching his tail. If that tail twitches, we're gonna get you back in the vehicle. something beautiful in the walk. Enjoy it with James, and we'll see you back here as soon as that tail tip twitches.
Well, everybody, just a quick one.
Oh, what's going on? Guys! Shh, Peter, shut up. Sorry, guys, I should be quiet. It's not like the water doesn't know there's a leopard in the hole with him. This is insane. I can't believe this. He's gone in the hole. Sorry, I'm just scrambling for my spotlight here. I can't see him at all now. Just moved a very little bit. I'm not going to go close. I just want to get a slightly different angle. But yeah, is he going to emerge with dinner? Or with dust? Who knows? There's a leopard in the ground. I can't hear a thing. There's no sound. You'd expect some kind of squealing or growling or fighting. I have no idea what's going on right now. There's movement. I can see a tail tip. He's coming out. Look at that tail. He's reversing. What is going on? What has he got? No, dust. Amazing. Didn't get anything. Yet. Full of sand. Shakes it off. Yo. The surprises never stop in the bush. Suddenly there's more flies. As he ran into that hole, he would have flushed a lot of flies that tend to live in the entrance of the hole where warthogs and so forth burrow in. Now I can imagine at this moment, at this very second, as we're sitting here and he's sitting there, there's a little warthog or two so far back in the den that they've probably pushed a new chamber into that burrow. But it's worked, well, at least for now. He'd really wedged himself in there. It looked like he was struggling to get out for a second or two. So my gut feeling would be that whatever he was going for is safe. But that's just a feeling. It's not to say he won't go back in there. It's not to say he might yet emerge with dinner. Now he's digging. I've watched lions dig out a burrow until they get to the warthogs. No reason why a leopard can't do that. Hello, Laura. And this is the beauty of guests that have been on many safaris with us. Laura, you're just saying that you believe that Tingana is the king of aardvark hunting. He's hunted a number of aardvark over the last year or so. Aardvark is a strange looking animal. It's an anteater. And very active at night. You don't see aardvark often in the day. In parts of the Kalahari you do. And they burrow deep in there, and I would think if there's an aardvark in there, it should get away from this guy. But then again, as you say, Laura, he is the artist. He's done this many times in the past. He will do so again in the future. Maybe he's busy doing so at the present. He's definitely digging a bit. Perhaps it's an aardvark. My gut feeling is warthog related, because we saw a warthog. It doesn't mean it is a warthog. This whole area we've been driving through, I kept mentioning lots of burrows and holes everywhere. Certainly enough to suggest a lot of aardvark activity. But this is a first for me too. I mean, I've seen leopard hunt warthog around burrows as they're coming out and so on, but I've never seen one go into a burrow like that. I have experienced it with lions where they dug for warthog. In fact, an experience in Bilansburg where the one lion got himself stuck in the burrow, it couldn't get out, and got himself in there and then couldn't turn around to get out. There he goes again. Cheryl, you're wondering how deep are those holes? They can be very deep. Looking at this one, it's certainly been dug a few times before. Looking at the sand outside, I would guess in the region of 3-4 meters, 5 meters, 10-15 feet. There's the tail doing a dance. It looks like a snake or an animal on its own. Wait, look at that. God. Sad as well. That was a very young warthog. I would say a day or two, three old. But that is also dinner for a leopard, energy for his next activities. And if it's any consolation for you, in Africa, I'm a little bit speechless, so sorry if I sound a bit, if you'd asked me today, what's the chance of us finding a leopard, hunting with him and seeing this, I would have told you maybe 1,000,000 to 1. Or if I was feeling very optimistic, I would have given you about 100,000 to 1 odds. But that's dinner for him. Sad for the warthog, but this is life for a leopard. Bart and everyone else experiencing this with us, as I said, there's that crazy mixture of emotion, of elation in the hunt and shock and sometimes sadness in the kill. But Bart, you were just saying this is the best, most riveting, most amazing real-time reality TV you've ever seen, and I have to say that out loud because you said it, and I can only agree. Realer than this it doesn't get. That emotion that you are feeling, and I'm not just talking about Bart, I'm talking about every one of you. That emotion that you are feeling right at this moment is because you have shared the excitement of the hunter looking for food and the mixed emotions you feel when the hunt happens. And something else with that is that emotion you couldn't have felt, couldn't have shared in the way you're doing right now if it wasn't live. This moment that you and I are sharing, we will remember perhaps for the rest of our lives. If we see each other 10 years from now, somewhere to say hello, and we refer back to this second, we would both remember the feeling that we had. Isn't that amazing? That's what Safari Live brings to you. And we hope to share a lot more of this with you on Nat.Geo Wild in the future. Very good question, Suzette. Very pertinent to the moment as well. We're going to show you quickly. We're going to try and move just a little bit. So just to show you the sort of setting here. Suzette, you're asking if leopard always take their food up a tree, Tingana. Typically does hoist his kill or take it up a tree. There's a perfect tree in the back, big marilla tree. There's a nice fork for him to put the kill in or up there somewhere, so it's very possibly might take it up. But at the same time, as you suggested, he will conserve energy by not taking it up. And this is such a small little warthog, when this would be the size of a normal Big Mac, you know, not like a double cheese one, just a normal one. This leopard, no fries on the side, just a snack. And unlikely he's going to take it up, he will eat it quite quickly. And at the same time, there wasn't a lot of noise. There was no squealing or other noise going on while he caught it. So it's not likely to attract a hyena. Let's try and see, can we move here? That's what he's doing right now, is he's listening, just looking around. He doesn't want to be surprised by another predator now. Yeah, we should get a good view here. There we go. It's as close as we can get. Perfect. Let me just get some lights on there for you. There we go. So yeah, just to finish that question, I don't think he's going to take this up the tree. It's too small. He'll finish this quickly. He's hungry. He will hunt again tonight maybe, but for now he's got food. He's got energy. He can continue being Tingana, the dominant male leopard of the Arathusa area here, where we are driving around. looking for wildlife, sharing moments, sharing experiences with each other. This is not to sensationalize this at all, but obviously this leopard has just caught his food. He eats it just like that. So if this is a little bit visceral or a little bit sort of too raw for you, just be wary. But at the same time, this is not a lion on a buffalo where it's a big bloody affair. This will be quick and easy. He's already eaten about a third of it. Kate, very good observational question. I love those questions. Isn't it beautiful? Look at those eyes. Pupils are big now. It's late. You know, it's getting dark around us. Asking, why is he licking it as opposed to sort of just biting big chunks off? Those of you that joined us in October for Shadows Hunt would remember those hyenas. They almost swallowed that impala whole. You will see he's licking it sometimes. Sometimes you'd get, well, just some of the blood off it or some of the smaller tissue off. He's got a very rough tongue. But look at how he's eating. You see he's using the side of his mouth. It's called the carnassial shears. I'm sure Hayden has showed you that a few times in the tent. Very interesting to see. But basically, so the equivalent of your teeth through to the back of your jaw, your molar teeth. In the leopard, those are sharp and they cut almost like scissors. Not almost like scissors. And that allows it to cut through bone, to cut through skin, cut through tissue. And very important, the canines, those long teeth that we think of. If you think of a leopard or a lion, you always think of the long teeth. The canines are very important for the hunt because that's what they grab on with. If they grab something by the throat, something bigger than a little warthog like that, let's say an impala or buffalo for lions, they grab onto the throat and they suffocate the prey. And the canines are important for that. But without the carnassial shears, those teeth at the back that they cut through the meat, they wouldn't be able to eat the meat because they wouldn't be able to slice through it or cut through it. So very important. And we've only got a few minutes left for this safari, but I think he might even finish most of that food in that time. Amazing. Yes, Davina, great question. We touched on it just now, but let me just reiterate. You were asking if there are other predators around at this time, and the question is a resounding yes. We could still, in the next 3.5 minutes, while you can join us, anything can happen in that sense. Hyenas can run in here suddenly. That's why he's looking around every now and again. He's listening. And he would have enough warning, at least 5 or 10 feet. If they're running in here, he would hear that noise from their feet coming through the grass. And he would react very quickly. He might run up that tree with the carcass. If it's too quick, he might leave it behind. But it's unlikely that he'll be surprised to the point where they can get hold of him. But certainly, yes, many other predators. Other leopard, certainly lion, hyena. They all moving around, and not only moving around, but opportunistically listening and looking for opportunities like this to steal food if they can. Yes, Andrine, saying that obviously the mother wasn't in the den. Two reasons that I can say yes to that. One is when we saw the sort of the preempting to this hunt, we saw a flash of a warthog running away. We went very close to him. We were busy catching up. And she, male leopard, living in a wild and free environment. He's not intimidated easily. Just something, we've sort of mentioned some of these things as we talked about it, but brilliant that you guys have so many questions about what's going on. Cody, you're just asking again whether this is enough for a meal. I think I compared it earlier to a sort of a Big Mac, but without any sides. You know, just that. So it's something that'll keep you going, but it certainly is not a big meal. He will probably hunt again tonight. It's a little bit overcast still. It's a good night. But yeah, this would be certainly enough to to make him feel like he's had a good meal, but it's not something that's going to last him for 3 or 4 or 5 days, like a, let's say, adult warthog or impala would have. But then he would also feed on that for a day or two. Well, as with all safaris, there has to be an end at some stage, and we're nearing that rapidly as we speak. Firstly, thank you so much, every single person. You have no idea how much it means to have you on safari, because it is you that makes it possible for us to do this and for us to share this with you. So hopefully there's going to be lots of this down the line. The experience was brilliant. I would not have enjoyed this as much if it wasn't for you guys with me. It's been an amazing time. And it's always fantastic being in the bush, and it's just been brilliant. VM behind the camera, as always, we have a brilliant time together in the bush. This has been very special, and yeah, I'm going to go too much and talk too much. This is a danger that I have. For now, thank you so much for being part of Big Cat Week, for being part of Safari Live, for being part of this real, as it happens, experience in the bush. And you know what? From all of you, I'm going to say a big thank you to Nat.Geo Wild for getting us to Africa in this special way. What an experience. We will see you again tomorrow. Bye-bye.